इलेक्ट्रिकल्स, सोलर फोटोवोल्टिक पैनल्स, सोलर एंड विंड पावर जनरेशन एक्सेट्रा. ही हैज बीन अवार्डेड एंटरप्रेन्योर ऑफ द ईयर अवार्ड बाय हैदराबाद मैनेजमेंट एसोसिएशन बाय द वाइस प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ इंडिया. ही इज एक्स चेयरमैन ऑफ तेलंगाना फिक्की. ही इज फाउंडर ऑफ यंग एंटरप्रेन्योर्स ग्रुप. ही इज सीनेट मेंबर ऑफ आईआईटी हैदराबाद एंड ही हैज इंटरेस्ट इन स्पोर्ट्स एंड अदर सोशल एक्टिविटीज. अ वेरी एक्टिव पर्सन एंड ऑलवेज अवेलेबल टू अस वेन एवर वी नीड हिज विजडम एंड गाइडेंस. ओवर टू यू देवेंद्र जी.
Thank you, Rakesh. In this uncertain times, like you said in the introduction, in this VUCA world, talking about the future of business. The future of business as it is a big question mark. There is no doubt about it. Future of business is going to be a very, very difficult task. But when you added the business of future, that is a very exciting area, very, very optimistic area, an area where the potential and the opportunities are endless. So it's a very interesting combination of the topic itself, which is there. So what I would like to do in the initial 10 odd minutes, which I thought I'll give my opening remarks, is instead of talking too much of specifics, I want to talk of three long-term trends, which are going to impact the businesses of today and that of tomorrow. Businesses of today negatively and businesses of tomorrow very, very positively. The first trend is what I call the Durga Lakshmi Saraswati trend. Sushma just shared a very elaborate screen of how businesses were over the last millennia. So what happened is in the first maybe 80% of that slide, all the businesses were demanded by literally brute strength and power. And that means the Durga, our goddess Durga, was the most powerful thing on earth. And whoever had the power of Durga could succeed in businesses. And this was a period where actually Europe took a big lead in the businesses. Then came the business of Lakshmi. That is the last 100 years. You see all the products and services which succeeded were based on wealth and on manufacturing. And America thrived on this. The future, according to me, is the business of Saraswati, which is creativity, knowledge, and innovation. These are the three things which will drive the businesses of future. So in a very simple nutshell, that is all the businesses of future are going to be. And if you see the businesses of Durga, were land, agri products, and materials. The businesses of Lakshmi were money and manufacturing. Today, across the world, half the economies have negative rate of interest. Money is losing its value, just like brute strength has lost its value more by Second World War. Money is already losing its value, and future is all going to be about Saraswati, knowledge, creativity, and innovation, not pure information. Information is also over. The days of information are also over. The second trend which I want to talk about, which are going to impact the businesses of future. Again, going back to history, a lot of you would know that in the year 1900, there were just 1 billion people on this earth. And just in this 100 years, the population has gone from 1 billion to 7.5 billion. So we have been a part of a generation which has seen unimaginable growth of population, and all our businesses today are based on continuously growing population. Unfortunately, this trend ends now. Just for your information, in the last 20 years, the number of childbirths across the world are stagnant. We are today growing in population only because of longevity. So what does this mean? This means that any businesses which depend on land or shortages or limited resources for growing population are businesses of yesterday. Any businesses which are based on children and youngsters are businesses of yesterday. The businesses of tomorrow are going to be asset light, without any resources, without any major property or stuff built upon it. Businesses which are asset light will be successful in future. Businesses which depend on geriatrics, will be successful in future. So what I feel that we should be looking at for businesses of future is this. Another data point on the demographics. If you know, the world today can be divided into 1-1-1-4. The Americas is 1 billion people. The Europe is 1 billion people. Africa is 1 billion people. And 4 billion people reside in Asia. The world of tomorrow is going to become 1-1-3-5, which means US will still be 1 billion. Europe will still be 1 billion. Africa will become 3 billion. And Asia will become 5 billion. What does this mean? For a very long time, business was totally oriented around the Atlantic Ocean. That is, between US and Europe is where the maximum amount of businesses happen. What is happening today? The business has already moved from the Atlantic Ocean to the Pacific Ocean. Between USA and Asia is the maximum amount of business which happens. What is the business of tomorrow? It's going to be the Indian Ocean. Between Asia and Africa is where you will see maximum amount of GDP going to be generated. And people who are focused on these two continents will do far better than those who are focused on our traditional markets in US and Europe. So China is a very, very big fulcrum for the business of future. Whatever we like to do China bashing, we have to understand, for business at least, China is going to be the integral part of business for future. Just like US was for the last 100 years, China is likely to be the integral part of businesses of future. Whether we like it or not, we have to look at that opportunity as an opportunity rather than a threat. So that is one thing which I feel, that is the second trend which I would like to look at. And the third trend, which probably is more important than the first two trends, is that we are now going to move into an era of surplus. See, while the population moved from 1 billion to 8 billion, there were so many doomsayers that there will be shortage of everything from oil to water to everything which you can think of, and there will be wars for shortage. But what we are seeing on the contrary is, because of the productivity growth, the earth has been able to produce not only for 1 billion, but also for 8 billion. And we see today in almost every sector, there is more than enough material available, including food. So that is, and this is in spite of the fact that we are consuming ever more resources. Each of us is consuming so much more than what our parents and grandparents were doing, and still there is so much more left. And what is going to happen in the future? Like I said, the population growth is slowing down. It will cap at 10 billion, but the productivity growth is going faster and faster in the future. So we are going to move in an era of surplus. What does this era of surplus mean? First, let me come to why this era of surplus is happening. The era of surplus is happening is because we are creating more and more productivity tools. All of us are becoming more and more productive. A meeting like this would probably take me 2 days to attend, go to Indore, go somewhere, go into a hotel, check in, and then attend the meeting. Now, in just 40 minutes of my time, I'm able to do the same productive work. And it is not only this, there are so many other things which are happening. Technology, telecom, internet is definitely one of the big drivers. But if you look at manufacturing, automation, miniaturization, if you look at every area of activity which is there. I remember when I just passed out of my college and I wanted to do a project report, it took me 6 months to get the basic data. Today, that is available to me in less than 10 minutes. So this way, the productivity and the networking is helping us increase productivity faster and faster. The productivity gain is becoming faster, and therefore will become into an era of surplus. How do you want to do business? If you can create the tools of productivity, you will be one of the geniuses of the world. If you can create something by which your customers can become more productive, if you can create tools by which the entire population can become more productive, you're going to get a big chunk of the pie. But that's more easier said than done. But the minimum which we can do as businesses is that we should use all these tools of productivity and ensure that our businesses are efficient in terms of using all the tools of productivity and make our products and our services at the lowest cost by the use of productivity. So the businesses of future is either create productive tools or at a minimum use the productive tools and ensure that you are at the top of the game. The second point, which is, of course, like I mentioned earlier, control of resources are going to be a waste because resources are going to be available in abundance. What you need to look at is how do you manage surpluses in the environment? Just to give an example, I mean, we talk about Uber and Airbnb. What they are doing is there is surplus amount of cars in the society. There's surplus amount of rooms which are lying vacant. If somebody can monetize them, then they make a lot of money. And likewise, there is going to be a surplus of every resources in the country. If you, for example, look at infrastructure machines, there are so many machines lying idle at various places because they don't know where to take it and who can use it at that point of time. So if somebody can utilize the surplus items, not only in IT or the amount of information which we have today, but also in all other areas, we will make a lot more money. So future businesses are going to be dependent on utilization of surpluses rather than control of shortages. So with this three basic mega trends, which I think which will force the businesses of future, I will leave it now so that we can have some time left over for discussion. I really like the panelists and what Sudhir and Sushma said. Really excited me. So if we can have a longer discussion on both of those things and other things, it'll be great.
Thank you, Devanji, for giving us
If you're talking about India, I am very, very bullish. Like I said, it's the era of Asia. China is definitely going to be a big story there. But if you look at India, what is going for India? I talked about demographics. China, unfortunately, is on the declining demographics. Their population is aging very fast. We have the youngest workforce. And believe me, the demographics speak very well for India. Secondly, we have a very low base. We still are consuming very little compared to, if you look at steel or copper or energy, we are still at 1/10 to 1/5 of China. So we have a big place to grow. We can have so much more growth possibility, which is happening in India. And definitely the spillover from the rest of the world will come to India because we are the only country which has active growing workforce in the age group of between 20 and 50. Very few countries really have that. The third and more importantly, the world is becoming a flat place. Globalization and digitization and plus our affinity to English and understanding what the world wants is so much better than China. I do work with China, and one of the biggest problems with China is you don't understand what they are saying. The biggest problem, yes, Vietnam is doing a fantastic job of, beating us to the goalpost, like they say. What could have come into China, India is suddenly being shifted to either Vietnam or Philippines or Malaysia. We are seeing it happen all around the place. It's not that India is not growing, but a lot of these opportunities are also spilling over all over the place. So I personally am a very big fan of the India growth story. I think if any place has to grow in the next 10-15 years, the maximum growth potential is in India. Yes, like Sudhir said, a lot of work has to be done by everybody. The governments on their part a little bit, the businesses like us on our part, the society, and all of us thought leaders who meet everywhere have to put in our bit everywhere. I personally feel, yes, India is in the sweetest spot possible. We are going to see a great growth story. And believe me, it's not all going to be honey and milk. Because of the way situation is panning out, there'll be a lot of businesses which will fall by the wayside. India is made out of businesses where we have a long, very long distribution chain. Today, with the disintermediation happening, every MSME is today able to cater to directly to consumer with maximum one or two intermediaries. So what is the fate of those intermediaries? Yes, we will face pain there. But just because there is a little bit of pain there, the consumer will get a much better and richer experience. So there will be a huge churn which will happen in the economy. With the huge churn, there will be about 30% of the people who will be badly hit, and they need to learn to re-engineer and move into areas which are viable. With the new economy, a lot of things are really irrelevant. And if you still continue to do the irrelevant things, you're not going to be successful in future. Believe me, in my own lifetime, I have closed down 4 factories because the life cycle of those factories is over. We need to learn that not everything will fall in place, and whatever is in place will also be disrupted. When the other panelists are saying we need to disrupt, what is the meaning of disruption? Disruption means changing the way the existing things are being done. So you will see a lot of people fall by the wayside. While there will be hundreds of winners, there will be 50 people who will be disrupted out of their business. So unless they act on their game, there's no point in crying and asking for help for that type of a business. So I think that is one thing which we need to understand, that disruption works both ways. Let us be looking at the positive aspects of disruption. Instead of trying to, you know, I've been seeing something on the MSME. We want to protect price growth in MSME because commodity prices are going up. Yes, they are going to hurt. But if you start looking at protectionism there, instead of looking at how you can innovatively get better products at a lower price or use this price increase to get your own thing moving, that is what we need to concentrate rather than cry about it. Thank you.
Very, very right.
Definitely technology looks great. Technology implementation and technology adoption is looking great to me. I think we will still see a lot of growth in entertainment opportunities outside the regular entertainment opportunities. Third one is creative use of, you know, all sorts of crazy things which are going around in the country. I mean, everything which is different will be an opportunity rather than going and looking at the traditional things. Anything which you are passionate about is an opportunity. That is my thought on it.
Okay. What is the strategy you recommend to the businessman in post-pandemic era?
Post-pandemic era, definitely we need to be prepared for the uncertain. Like I said, the world is a VUCA world, but it is throwing up so many opportunities to be alive for the opportunities which are coming your way and be ready to pivot. Don't be held up, like somebody said, 3-generation businesses. Don't be held up that this is what I have been always doing. Be ready to pivot very fast and change into areas which are probably related but totally different.
What do you suggest change in the mindset of people?
Change in the mindset, first of all, stop the negativity. Be positive. Positive about the growth opportunities which are going to come about it. And stop crying about overspilt milk. What has happened has happened.
Your message to the worried businessman today?
Again, the same thing. There is no point in crying about what has happened. But the opportunities are huge. Look at what you can do to create value in the society. If you can create value to the society in some form or the other, part of that value will come back to you, even if you are not able to capture that value in the immediate right now. Do something right, which is useful for the society as a business.
Very right. Over to